major who's really caused us to rethink how we remember the civil rights movement. As recently as 15 years ago, you know, if you said civil rights movement, you would have thought, oh, you know, Montgomery, Alabama, Selma, et cetera, et cetera. And Clarence Taylor and his colleagues have shown us that there is an equally rich and different civil rights movement and struggle in the urban north. As is to him and a number of colleagues, Thomas Drew, Gene, Gene Harris, many others to whom we owe, you know, those insights. He also writes on African American religion as well. He has written and edited four books. The first, The Black Churches of Brooklyn, which came out of Columbia University Press in 1994 and was on my examination committee, actually, man.
Really?
Yeah, yeah. When I took my exams in the late 90s. The Black Churches of Brooklyn is a critically acclaimed work that centers on the development of the religious community in Brooklyn, New York City. It examines the institutional development as well as the social activism of black churches themselves. And the Black Churches of Brooklyn, he argues, not only helped shape the city of churches, but also shaped, they were also shaped by the cultural changes and social movements of Brooklyn. As you can imagine, we didn't have you read any from that book, but you can imagine the kind of seamless transition from that stage of his work into the his later work, which included the next book, Knocking at Our Own Door, Milton A. Galamison, that is how you pronounce it, right?
That's correct. Yeah.
Milton A. Galamison and the Struggle to Integrate New York City Schools, also on Columbia Press, only 3 years later.
Yeah.
I'm starting to feel a certain way right now.
Like, I can talk about that.
Yeah, man. Please do. Share your secret with me. All right. Milton Glamison, The Struggle to Integrate New York City Schools, came out in 1997. Is the most extensive work on Milton Glamison, leader of the New York City school integration struggle in the 1950s and 1960s. This work, as I said at the top of my comments, challenges the Southern paradigm of civil rights historiography by exploring the efforts of civil rights activists and organizations in New York. And I said as recently as 10 or 15 years ago, we were thinking about this book was almost 20 years ago. So clearly, as I said, Professor Taylor was at the cutting edge of this historiography. It's received numerous positive reviews. It's been cited by numerous scholars working on modern New York City and northern civil rights history. I personally recommend it when you get a chance. It has received honorable mention from the Gustavus Myers Program for the Study of Bigotry and Human Rights in North America. Professor Taylor has been at Brooke College since 2004. His teaching interests are the modern civil rights and black power movements, modern New York City history, African American religion, and African American history from Reconstruction to the present, and also the history of the American working class. Please join me in welcoming our special guest.
Thank you. Is this good? I'm going to make sure. Okay. I'm sorry about you have to sort of turn around and face me, but that's so. I'm very happy to be here today. Thank you for inviting me, and anytime I can talk about my work is always good, you know. And what I thought I would start is talking about the last book I wrote, Reds at the Blackboard, and I think you've read some chapters of that book. And then talk about the Galamison book, and if I have time, then talk about the new project that I'm working on, looking at how people organize to take on police brutality in New York City from the 1930s on. So, in terms of Reds at the Blackboard, this is a project I was working on for over a decade. In fact, actually, even earlier than this. This was going to be my dissertation, this book. But my advisor warned me not to do it. He said, I will never get it passed the executive committee at the Graduate Center because of the reputation, the history of this union. And he was right. So I did the Black Churches of Brooklyn as my dissertation, and then became my first book, and I did a few other books before I came back to this project. And the reason I was interested in this predominantly communist-led union, mostly white teachers, is because of my own involvement in the teacher union struggle. Now, before I started to teach college, I was a elementary, junior high school, and high school teacher, you know, almost 15 years in the New York City public school system. And early on in my career, I got involved in union politics. But I was involved in the opposition of the dominant caucus, because the union is made up of various caucuses. And at the time, the dominant caucus was led by Al Shanker, known as, it's an oxymoron, the Progressive Caucus, right, as it was called. Well, I got involved in a group called the Teachers Action Caucus. And the Teacher Action Caucus grew out of teachers who were involved in the 1968 teacher strike, who defied their union by crossing the picket line. There were close to 7,000 of these teachers who defied that strike, because they made the argument that strike was not a strike dealing with management. It was not a strike between labor and management over, you know, collective bargaining issues. This was a strike against the black Latino communities of New York City. And so that's why they sort of defied their union. And so, you know, once the strike is over, these teachers did not just disappear. You know, they formed this caucus and they worked within the UFT to push a much more progressive agenda. And among these teachers were a number who I thought were retired teachers who were working, people who then were in their 70s and 80s, who were dedicated to the sort of union activism. But I would later find out that many of these teachers were not retired teachers. These were teachers who had been fired from the public school system because they were involved in an earlier union, the teachers union. And it's quite interesting, when I attempted to talk to every one of those teachers, they did not want to have a conversation about their past. And I thought that was quite odd. That's strange that they never wanted to talk to me about their past. And I became friends with some of these folks. But nevertheless, when I kept bringing up the subject, you know, they sort of said, well, no, we really don't want to, you know, discuss it. Well, eventually I did go back to working on the New York City Teachers Union book, and there, it was a daunting task. Let me know that there were just numerous archival materials. Here's a case where people, this is the case where people, you know, you're doing research, you go around looking and trying to find sources. Here, this was a case of too many sources. Because when you had the teachers' union papers at Cornell University, the Industrial Labor School, and that was over 100 boxes, making up over 1,000 files. In addition, you had the New York City Board of Education papers, over 100 boxes and over 1,000 files. There's the AFT collection at Wayne State. In addition, at the Tamiman Library, there are archival materials and papers and so forth. So this is a case where there's sort of too much material and you have to decide, you know, essentially how to sort of craft the story. But it came clear to me as I was doing the research, the dominant notion, you know, we talk about the historiography of the teachers union, because there is a historiography. The dominant narrative of the teachers union was that, first of all, it wasn't a teachers union. It was nothing more than a communist front attempting to capture the labor movement. Philip Taff, in his book, United They Teach, A History of the United Federation of Teachers, has several chapters making this argument. There is a book back in 1959 by Robert Iverson, Communists and the Teachers, makes this argument. There are other works also, Bella Dodd, who was an extremely important figure in the teachers' union, wrote a book, and you can get this one online. You don't have to go searching for it. It's amazing how all the anti-communist stuff is right online, so it's really easy to get. It's called Schools of Darkness. And she gives a history.
Schools of Darkness.
Title.
Exactly a subtle title.
No, it isn't. No. And Bella Dodd is an extremely important person because she was the main figure in the TU for a number of years, who would later turn against the teachers' union and become the number one informer for the New York City Board of Education and, of course, for HUAC.
HUAC is...
The House on Un-American Activities Committee, right? A branch of government that was formed in 1938 and by the 1950s is one of the leading federal branches investigating people who are members of the Communist Party, people who are on the left, you know, essentially attempting to purge organizations, institutions, people who are on the left. You know, so yeah, HUAC is an important institution. This was a sort of dominant narrative of the history of the teachers' union. In fact, I was just stating a few years ago, I gave a talk at the Tamament at NYU to a group about this upcoming book before the book came out. And Diane Ravitch, how many people heard of Diane Ravitch? Yeah, she is now big because she is the person taking on the charter school movement. Well, before Diane Ravitch became good in some sense, she was really an extreme right winger. Yeah. And she wrote a piece in this New York City it was a daily publication, I forgot the name of it. It was a neoconservative publication, essentially attacking me. She wasn't at the talk, but obviously the people who were there, some of them were upset that I was even giving this talk on the teachers' union at the Tamament. I guess they went back and reported to her, and so she writes this editorial attacking me, noting that, you know, Clarence Taylor gave this talk at the Tamarind on the teachers' union. This is what he should have said about the teachers' union. And went on to give the sort of anti-communist line that the union was essentially not a union, and that teachers back in 1960s essentially voted it out. And this is the story that he should have told. Well, the research demonstrates something completely different. Well, before I do that, I should note that there is an opposition to that narrative. And I call this a sort of revisionist narrative by scholars who do talk about the teachers' union and its good work, especially its fight for racial equality, but they ignore the communist connection. When they do bring it up, they usually say it was used to red bait the teachers' union. And so, you know, I said, you know, there has to be something. We can't sort of deny its communist connection. it is pretty clear, you know, from the archival material, from my discussions with many of these teachers, with government data, that, you know, they were members of the American Communist Party. They were adopting the positions of the American Communist Party. But the question that I raise as I'm going through this, okay, so, you know, how did that inform their vision of teacher unionism? Did it essentially take away, was this an objective of, was their objective what to essentially hand the union over to the American Communist Party? And, you know, it's clear that these teachers had a certain vision of unionism. And I think their Marxist background or their Marxist position helped them. These teachers pushed what I call sort of social unionism. And this has become pretty big in labor studies, you know, the study of social unionism. And they went beyond the sort of bread and butter unionism that we see today. For them, they connected essentially their concerns, the type of unionism, with that of the communities in which they served. So yes, they did fight for better wages for teachers, better working conditions, you know, to improve the grievance procedure. But they also worked in the communities for better schools, for new schools, new buildings, right? They worked to end racism in the New York City public school system. They worked to hire more Black and Latino teachers. And so for the teachers union, it's, you know, it was not just a matter of, you know, improving the conditions of the professionals. And the teachers union did this in several ways. It wasn't a sort of, what's it, 9 to 5 or 9 to 3, I forgot how many hours the teachers were. 6 hours and 20 minutes, that's my contract, right? For them, after the last class, you know, they went to meetings in the communities. Now, they joined the Harlem committee. They joined the Bedford-Stuyvesant and Williamsburg School Council, and there was a Harlem Council also for schools. And there were several of these councils in several places that teachers, you know, these teachers took part in. And it wasn't like they didn't step up to the leadership role. They were fully aware that they were there to help serve the community. So, now I need to go. Okay, thank you. I'll tell you when to stop. Go ahead. Keep going. Next. All right, next one. Next one. Here we go. Thank you. So this is an example of what I'm talking about. This is a PS3 in Brooklyn example. And Mildred Flax, who was a member of the Teachers Union, also a member of the American Communist Party, is involved in this, you know, committee of parents, in particular, you know, the school councils, but also the parent teachers associations. So when you think about the parent teachers associations, we usually think of organizations that, you know, parents belong to, particularly women who donate, have bake sales and cakes, all this, apolitical, right? These union, these parent teachers associations were extremely political. So they were pushing for improving conditions in those schools, you know, because in Bedford-Stuyvesant, which this school was located, in Harlem, they had the oldest buildings in the city, school buildings in the city. Some at this point over 100 years old. Some of them in such a poor shape they couldn't hold classes in the classroom. They were holding them in a stairwell. So this is the push for the Board of Education to build new buildings in these communities. Can you go back one? Go back one more. Good, okay. In terms of education, the teachers push for what they call intercultural education. The forerunner of multiculturalism, right?
Yeah.
Right. They called it intercultural education. And an interesting photo, you see the black child here. Yes. They said that teachers need to take these, what they call these sort of after school courses or these training courses. I forgot what they are called, that, where teachers are required to take, I'm sorry, what? Yeah, they had another name for them, but in-service, yes, in-service courses. They take these in-service courses, and they were able to persuade the Board of Education to accept an intercultural education in-service course for teachers. So what did this mean? This meant that teachers would be introduced to Black culture, Latino culture, culture of white ethnic groups. So this is the best way of essentially dealing with sort of ignorance of many of these teachers and attacking their racism. Get back. Keep going, I'm sorry.
This is the beginning.
The union mandated those courses?
I'm sorry?
The union mandated those courses?
Well, the union had the Board of Education mandate them. They got permission to do that. Yeah, you know, maybe I should go back.
This is the first slide.
Oh, okay, so yeah, let's keep going. I'm sorry. The one where you sort of keep. Yeah, hold it right there. Nope. Okay, good. Now, by the 1940s, the teachers' unions attacked the textbooks that were being used in the New York City public school system. Bias and Prejudice in textbooks in New York City schools was this huge document where the teachers took excerpts from high school and junior high school textbooks, usually the social studies textbooks, but also in literature and so forth, noting the racism in those books, noting that the board was peddling racism to over a million children in the New York City public school system. So some of those textbooks, I remember as a kid, like Little Black Sambo. Was used in the New York City public school system when I was a child. High school textbooks that justified slavery, noting that it was a benign institution. Textbooks that painted Reconstruction as a tragic era in American history. And so it's the teachers union that sort of takes this on. So they made thousands of these pamphlets, circulating them throughout the New York City school system, putting pressure on the Board of Education to eliminate those racist textbooks, and noting that this was not a case of censorship. Essentially, what we are attempting to do is, I mean, this is democracy, you know, so we want to sort of get rid of the racist distortions that teachers of essentially peddling in their classrooms by using these textbooks. And they said, no, they should, and they note this in this document, that many of the textbooks were authored by principals, assistant superintendents, and the superintendent who gave them the most trouble, a man by the name of William Jansen. And eventually they were successful. They managed to have many of those textbooks removed from the schools. Now, this was the campaign, part of the civil rights campaign of the New York City Teachers Union. In addition to eliminating textbooks, they also led a fight to hire black teachers in the schools. By 1953, New York City black teaching staff was, people with full-time licenses to teach, was about 2.5%. And if you added the people who were substitute teachers, it moved it up to about 4.5%. Now, how do we know this? The New York City Board of Education, when confronted by the TU on this very issue, the board's response was, we don't take records. We have no idea of the racial makeup of the staff. You know, we're just hiring the best qualified people, this argument. So it's the teachers union that takes the surveys, going into schools and noting the makeup of the professional staffs in the schools. And they publish this stuff, and they hand it out. And they note, they challenge the argument, well, when you've heard this argument before, well, there aren't enough black teachers, you know, where are we gonna find them, and so on and so forth. They say, well, you know, you can go to predominantly black universities, colleges, and offer positions to teachers. Now, we have cases in the South where many black teachers are being fired, offer them positions. So they also offered, you know, solutions to this problem that the New York City Board of Education, you know, completely ignored. This was an extremely tough battle. It isn't actually until the 1980s that the New York City Board of Education, along with Boston, essentially forced to integrate the school system by a federal judge, I should note. My then TU is long gone. But this was a courageous fight on the part of the New York City Teachers Union. In addition, the union also pushed Black History Month, Negro History Month. If you hit the next one, yeah, there you go. Negro History Week, sorry. I forgot it was only a week back then, right? Negro History Week. And in their publication, they would have, they would dedicate essentially their publication in New York City Teacher News, or New York Teacher News, to Black History Week. And they would have writings from Carter G. Woodson, W.E.B. Du Bois. They would focus on prominent African Americans, you know, such as Thurgood Marshall and so forth. And in addition to this, they also created kits on Black history. And those kits specifically targeted certain periods in time, like Reconstruction or the American Revolution, and they would hand these out to schools. Noting that essentially what the problem is that teachers don't know this, they don't have the material. If they had the material, this is sort of naive on the part of the teachers union, if they had the material, they would teach this material. But once again, they say it's extremely important because not only do we have to sort of counter the racist textbooks that are being used in the school system, you know, we have to essentially remedy this by teaching, giving a corrective. So in large this part, this was the sort of civil rights agenda of the teachers union. Now, you know, some historians I have to mention have noted some of these aspects of the teachers union, you know. But, you know, no one really sort of measures, no one has really measured the impact that the union had. And it would have essentially a profound impact much later on, because the United Federation of Teachers essentially sort of adopted this model. Not giving credit to the teachers' union. But by the 1970s, the United Federation of Teachers, sort of, they're putting out their own material on black history. And some of it, I should know, they lifted from the materials of the teachers' union. Now, what happened to this union is they essentially, it was essentially dismantled. Now, one of the points that Diane Ravitch made is that the teachers' union essentially folded because no one was buying their line. Essentially, they were communists, and you know, no one was going for that. Instead, they chose the other union, and that other union was essentially the United Federation of Teachers, which has sole collective bargaining power, and they gained that in 1960. But the real story is that the union came under attack. The TU came under attack the second the communists took over in 1935. They took over, this was the largest union in the city. When the communists gained control of that union, 700 members of that union walked out. They formed an opposition union called the Teachers Guild, which would later become the United Federation of Teachers. But the American Federation of Teachers came after the TU and eventually took away their charter. By the 1950s, they were already in these Congress of Industrial Organizations, and the Congress of Industrial Organizations would revoke their charter. But more importantly, it's the New York City Board of Education, along with the United States federal government, I already mentioned UAC, the New York City Police Department, and its infamous Red Squad, the New York State law enforcement, they all come after this one union. And I should also mention the Catholic Church. Plays a major role in going after this union. And it's a person who essentially is representing the Catholic Church, a man by the name of, he's an attorney who was elected to the Board of Education, a man by the name of Timon, who pushes something known as the Timon Resolution. The board accepts it, and they ban the teachers' union from any activities in the New York City public school system. In addition, over 700 teachers are called before the superintendent or his representative and questioned. Many of these teachers were forced to resign, forced to retire, or they were fired. And so it is this attack by all these forces that eventually does force the union to fold in 1964. And the problem with this is, as I argue, I sort of hint at it in the book, that eventually what takes place when this union folds is that we lose this brand of unionism, sort of social justice unionism that was being pushed by the New York City Teachers Union. and we wind up with another brand of unionism, quite militant, pushing to improve wages, working conditions, the grievance procedure, all that stuff for teachers, but not having any strong connection to the communities they served. And so we wind up in 1968. And for those who are familiar with 1968, that's when you had the New York City teacher strike. The longest teacher strike in American history, I should note, almost 3 months. The strike goes on. It's actually three strikes, but Barry White talks about it as sort of just one strike. And what motivated this strike was the fight over community control. Fight over community control. Now, I don't know how much should I?
You're good.
I'm good, so I can move into talking about, okay, good. So I wrote this book. This book was published in 2011, but it sort of predates the book that I wrote in 1997, looking at the school integration struggle in New York City. Now, that struggle it begins long before, as I note here, the teachers' union is essentially pushing to integrate the New York City school system, and also the student body, I should note. One thing I didn't note in my talk, my presentation, that it did push to integrate the New York City school body, student body, by making arguments that, hey, you know, the New York City Board of Education is sort of zoning black kids to sort of segregated schools. They need to sort of stop that. but it's the civil rights community that sort of picks up on that argument. And so by the 1950s, it becomes crystal clear to everyone that, you know, New York City school system is thoroughly segregated. Thoroughly segregated. Now, the focus of that book, I should know, what sort of led me to that book, and this is answering the point why it came out 3 years after Black Churches of Brooklyn, is because of Milton Inglamison. I had interviewed Milton Inglamison, who was pastor of Siloam Presbyterian Church in Brooklyn and Bed-Stuy, the largest Black Presbyterian church in the country. Let me ask this question. How many people heard of Inglamison? One person. That's why, because I spoke two months ago to a church group, and there were a lot of people in there my age and a lot older. And it was a Black Baptist organization, and I had mentioned Inglamison. 200 people sitting in that room, and not one of them, when I said, "Do you know Inglamison?" Not one of them raised their hand. He's a person who sort of just like disappeared. It's like Al Sharpton notes in his autobiography, and it's a pretty good autobiography, but he notes in his autobiography he brought the civil rights movement to New York City. Well, you know, I mean, Al Sharpton did a lot of things, but that's something he didn't do, I can tell you that. It was there long before Al Sharpton. And so Glamison sort of disappears from the scene, although he was in the newspaper every single day back in the 1960s, early 1960s. Late 1950s, early, by the 1960s, when this movement heats up, I mean, every day he's in. He's arrested several times for his actions. So Glamison comes to Presbyterian, Siloam Presbyterian Church in 1948 at the age of 26. Young. He has a master's degree in theology from Princeton University. Siloam is a consciously black middle-class church. And people who I interviewed noted that if you weren't even the right skin tone or color, you couldn't get into Siloam Presbyterian Church. So he comes to this church, and he immediately, from his sermons, which, by the way, you can go to the Schomburg, and all the sermons are there at the Schomburg. You know?
These are recorded or written?
No, these are written.
Written down.
Yeah, written sermons. Yeah.
That's where his papers are? Glenn's papers at the Schomburg?
His papers in two places. The Schomburg, that's where they have all the sermons and have some other stuff. But in terms of some of his activities with Brooklyn Core, with the whole Downstate Medical Center campaign movement, those are at the State Historical Society, Wisconsin, Madison. How they got there, it's beyond me, but that's where they are. But they're on microfilm, so you can actually get them, you know, into library loan, and they are quite good. But yeah, so, and I have anybody here from the Brooklyn Historical Society? Good. I actually have a taped interview with Glamison, and I need to sort of deposit this stuff and sort of get rid of. This with also with a person by the name of Oliver Leeds and Marjorie Leeds, who they were the head of Brooklyn Core back in the early 60s and so forth. But anyway, Glamison, you know, I interviewed him when I was working on the dissertation. And I knew the name Glamison, you know, growing up in New York City. But when I interviewed him, and only to talk about the Downstate Medical Center campaign of 1963, where for 2 weeks the black ministers of Brooklyn came out on the streets. They're members of the church, the pastors also, you know, when they were building the Downstate Medical Center campaign, they demanded that 25% of that workforce be black and Latino. They said black and Puerto Rican. That was the terminology they used. At that time, they blocked the bulldozers, they chained themselves to the construction sites. I mean, this was a really fierce campaign, and Glamison was one of the leaders of this campaign. So I sort of interviewed him on this, but then we went into other activities of Glamison, including his struggle to integrate the New York City school system. I said, that sort of sparked my interest. As soon as I deposited the dissertation, I'm going to go write on this. Because I wanted to come back and interview Glamison again. Unfortunately, he passed away before I could get a second chance to interview him. But the record is pretty clear that the New York City public school system was thoroughly segregated. The New York City Board of Education actually issued a statement after the Brown decision was handed down in 1954, praising the decision. But it's the psychologist Kenneth Clark, the first African American to receive a tenured position at City College, who gives this talk, really a scathing talk, the New York City Board of Education, and its sort of racial practices, how it has segregated students, and the profound impact the segregation has had on students. And the Board of Education, based on that talk, does a study. Well, they ask an organization to do a study. Are the schools really segregated? As if they didn't know. And of course, the report comes back, says, yes, they are segregated. They note that when they talk about segregation, they give this sort of definition where the school is 90% made up of Black and Latino students. You know, that's the bar, 90%. And there are loads of schools in New York City that are 90% or more Black and Latino. And so the board then says, well, we'll have to sort of address this problem, but civil rights community really said, well, no, let's sort of push them to do it. And it's the Brooklyn NAACP that sort of tries to step out in front. At least some of the members, the more radical left members of that group, attempt to do so. And particularly a person by the name of Andy Stein, who is a member of the American Communist Party, but she's red-baited. She and other members are red-baited in the Brooklyn NAACP. So they turn to Milton Glamison. Glamison says, okay, I'll help you out. He then runs for, eventually he wins the presidency of the Brooklyn branch of the NAACP. And he organizes, they organizes this group that sort of, like I said, a cadre that sort of takes on the New York City Board of Education. But because of his problems with the national organization, NAACP, he has to leave. He decides to leave. He doesn't have to leave, but he knows he's not going anywhere with Roy Wilkins, so he decides he has to get out and leaves and forms something, a group called the Parents Committee for, no, I'm getting it wrong, Parents Workshop. Parents Workshop for School Integration. And this group, I know it's not just Glamison. Remember I talked about the activities of the Parent Teachers Association? It's those Parent Teachers Associations throughout the city that are running and operating the Parents Workshop. The Parents Workshop for Equality in New York City Schools. That's the complete title of the group. And they, from early on, in the, from by 1955, they are having these massive campaigns with pressure on the New York City Board of Education to integrate. They include boycotts. They include sitting in the superintendent's office. They weren't chancellors, and they were superintendents. It included setting up meetings with board officials. Glamison would do this, and they think that Glamison would come by himself, but then he would come with 50, 60 people to attend this meeting. So they're using all these sort of tactics to put pressure on the school system to force it to integrate. And they run against the wall because the board is refusing. And one reason the board is refusing is they make this argument that we have to go by the neighborhood school concept. Kids should go to school in their own neighborhoods. Well, those Parent Teachers Associations, along with Annie Stein, done a lot of research. And they know, they said, well, you know, we have proof that you are zoning kids, even when they live in the same areas. You're zoning Black kids to one school and white kids to the other. And they hand this information over to the New York City Board of Education. So it's clear it's the New York City Board of Education's policies that are segregating these schools. And eventually, this leads to the largest civil rights demonstration in the nation. Interesting, the largest demonstration did not take place in Birmingham, didn't take place in Selma. It took place in New York City on February 3rd, 1964, where close to 500,000 public school kids stay out of school to force the New York City Board of Education to come up with a plan and a timetable to integrate the schools. The organizer, Glamison's the leader of that, the organizer of that 1964 demonstration is Byatt Rustin. Who had just come up with a successful organizing campaign in Washington, D.C., right? The March on Washington, right? It's like, he's in New York, Clarence brings him to New York City. And it's Rustin who really sort of organizes this thing and gets it off. It is so successful that Martin Luther King Jr. calls, or he attempts to call Glamis, who had never traveled south to take part in a civil rights demonstration. He makes it in New York City. And King wants to congratulate him. He doesn't do it. I'll tell you why in a minute. And on the verge of success, it crumbles, falls apart. One of the arguments that...
This is Sarah Koenig. Thanks for tuning into Serial Season 2 on Pandora.
Okay, I have competition here. Right? One of the reasons why we don't sort of focus on this, and we need to ask the question, why isn't this part of, when they talk about the civil rights narrative, why isn't this part of what the historians have called the sort of master narrative or the dominant narrative? You know, I mean, think of the narrative. What do we see? We see the Montgomery bus boycott. When I say this, we see it. When I say we see it, right?
Yes.
Documentaries, right? Commercial film, right? Commemorations, how many 50th anniversaries have we celebrated over the last few years, right? So you got the Montgomery bus boycott, right? You move from Montgomery to... Well, before the Freedom Rides, you got Little Rock, Arkansas, right? You're talking about Little Rock in 57. And then the sit-ins. Then the Freedom Rides, right? Because you got 60, 61. And then the March on Washington, 63, 64, Mississippi Freedom Campaign, 65, Selma. And we triumphed because we went up eliminating legally Jim Crow, right, through the 1964 Civil Rights Act and 1965 Voting Rights Act. So it's presented as a triumph. When you add places like New York and Philadelphia and Chicago and Boston, guess what? You don't have a narrative of triumph. It's not there. So this also, we like good stories. So as one historian has said, when we talk about the sort of civil rights movement and we have all these commemorations, especially looking at the sort of southern aspect, the wing of that movement or the southern paradigm, we like it because it tells us how bad the nation was, how bad we were, well, look how far we've come, right? Sort of pat ourselves on the back and, you know, on the chest and so forth and say, look what we have, you know, overtaken, you know, overcome, you know? And everyone uses that story, right? I mean, listen to Obama, listen, you know, to Clinton. I mean, they all use it. But, you know, I could have swore when the 50th anniversary of the New York City school demonstration rolled around 2 years ago, I said, I'm waiting for that call. I know Brian Lehrer and them on NPR is going to give me a call to ask me about it. Like, nothing, right? Not even recently, there's an NPR story. Jasmine Khan did it just a few months ago, looking at the 1964 boycott. But yeah, this was the largest civil rights demonstration in the nation. Now, why did it fall apart? It fell apart because, well, one group that takes credit for dismantling that boycott movement was the FBI. The Federal Bureau of Investigation was looking at Glamison for a long time. When I attempted to get the Glamison's FBI file before the hardcover edition of the book came on, I said, well, you know, I applied for it. When I started writing the book, the FBI kept sending me back this, or the Justice Department, I should say, kept sending me back this notice. We're very busy. Well, prove that he's dead. That was the first thing. Prove that he's dead. So I said, okay, good. It's obviously they're playing games, right? So, you know, I sent them an obituary, and then they sent me this letter a few months later. Okay, you're on a waiting list. We're extremely busy. We would appreciate you essentially dropping your request. And I said, no, I want it, right? And this went on for 5 years. 5 years. Eventually, a friend of mine who was the associate dean of the law school at Syracuse University says, well, I'll help you. She stepped in, and she essentially wrote this letter noting that they were in violation of the FOIA Act. And sure enough, I mean, the hardcover book had already come out, so I said, well, you know, the paperback edition is coming, so. And sure enough, after that threatening letter from, you know, that I was going to take legal action, it winds up in the mail. A lot of it didacted, let me tell you. I mean, it's just like, there's black lines right through. But there was enough material there to know that, you know, this guy had been a target of the FBI. And it's clear in the reports there that they wanted to dismantle the movement. And when, after the boycott, when the civil rights organizations who were part of that boycott decide to leave and walk away, Bayard Rustin also walks away. The FBI is patting itself on the back, J. Edgar Hoover says, look what we did. We are quite successful. But the reality is the FBI had little to do with the dismantling of the New York City school integration struggle. I put the blame in large part on Glamison. Sorry to say that Glamison did not know how to work as a sort of leader in that struggle. And it's clear from Bayard Rustin, who's working with him. And so when King calls Bayard Rustin and says, I want to congratulate him, it's Bayard Rustin, the phone conversation, he says, no, don't do that. He says, this guy's too explosive. And you know, you need to stay away from him. When I interviewed Glamison and I spoke to him about Bayard Rustin, his response to me, Bayard Rustin sold out more Negroes than all the African chiefs combined. He said that 20 years later, right? After this thing, right? And so when I asked him about it, he said, well, you know, he began to talk about his working style and how he sort of handled it. He says, you know, I didn't take dissent. I just, you know, people were sort of, that wasn't it, you know, because people were just wasting time. And so that's when these sort of civil rights organizations sort of, they in large part say, okay, we really can't work with this guy. We sort of have to walk away from him. So in large part, I think Glamison is, you know, has to be held responsible for a sort of breakup of the movement, you know, despite what J. Edgar Hoover and the FBI, they were, you know, jumping up and down, praising themselves. But it's an important story in the school struggle, because after the school integration struggle lasted over a decade. Over a decade. And when it falls apart, we have the emergence of the community control struggle in New York City. And Glamison reappears in that struggle also. So, you know, do I have time to talk about my next work, or do I? Oh, okay, good. Okay. So, education, I mean, the whole school struggle, part of that, as I have argued, part of that sort of civil rights, part of that civil rights struggle. And we should never see it as a sort of a Southern paradigm. And luckily, we have loads of books and loads of scholars who are now coming out looking at other works, like works on Philadelphia. You know, we've seen Thomas Agru, who takes a look nationally, regionally at the North in its struggles. There's books, book on Milwaukee and so on and so forth. So a number of books noting these long struggles for civil rights in New York City. And one issue that is clearly part of that Northern struggle is police brutality.
That was way back then, though, right? It's not an issue anymore.
Not an issue. Well, no, we think it just sort of popped up. You know, when you read folks, I mean, I'm reading an interesting book, Norm Stapler's book, who was the police chief San Diego. It was really good. When I heard this guy on WBAA, Democracy Now!, I said, well, you got to be good, even though he was a police chief. He's really criticizing the police, really going after them, and criticizing police. Yeah, so he's been pretty good. But all these stories, not all of them, but a lot of them, I think this problem sort of began in the 1990s. Some think it began even later. The ones who talk about earlier police brutality go back to the 1960s. But this has been, as Marilyn Johnson notes in her book called Street Justice, you know, this has been a problem since the formation of police departments in the 19th century. Right. Now, I start, this book I'm focusing on starts in the 1930s because I'm looking at protracted campaigns, ongoing campaigns. So Johnson notes that there were these moments where people sort of came up and organized against police brutality, but it isn't until the Harlem riots in 1935, and then again in 1943, that people start merely organizing and taking on the sort of, they see the long picture in terms of challenging police brutality. And in this work, I focus on various groups that people have never really focused on, never talked about, including the black press, and one paper in particular, The People's Voice. You've all heard the Amsterdam News, right? If you live in New York City, you heard the Amsterdam News. You may not have heard of the New York Age. Heard of the New York Age? It's defunct, but it was a prominent black publication. How many people heard of the People's Voice? Yeah, okay, a couple of people. Well, this is a paper that only lasted 8 years, 1942 to 6 years, either 6 or 8 years. And it started by Adam Clayton Powell Jr. Adam Clayton Powell Jr. in the 1940s was one of the most important civil rights activists in the city. In 1941, he led that Harlem bus boycott, along with Michael Quill of the Transport Workers Union. But Powell decides he needs a publication, one to promote himself, but also to get serious and focus on the problems of Harlem. Because he said the Amsterdam News is sensational. It's, you know, they're out there focusing on all kinds of sort of nonsense. He said, we really need a paper that is going to take this community serious, focus on its problems. And it is one, he hires an interesting group of people. You know, he's hiring people who are members of the American Communist Party. He's hiring people who, you have a background in journalism. He's taking, he's stealing a lot of people from the Amsterdam News that are coming over and joining the People's Voice. And it really has a serious tone. And the issue that it takes on, the greatest issue it takes, I mean, the issue that it really focuses on is police brutality. At least for the first 6 years of the paper's existence, for the paper's existence.
Professor, yeah. Just once again, when did the paper begin, more or less?
It began in 1940, around 1942, I believe. All the copies are at the Schomburg, by the way.
Just adding to that, we, Professor Farah Griffin spoke with us yesterday.
Yeah.
And she was talking about the Black Arts Movement during the Popular Front period. So I'm just noting that this is during that same period where someone like Adam Clayton Powell, who has really never been a radical, I don't think we'd ever say that, but he's hiring communists on his newspaper.
Yeah.
I imagine there might be something that changes later. I don't want to
say he does change, yes. Yeah. Powell does change. But yeah, I mean, he's. I mean, the paper's amazing. I mean, it has guest columns by Earl Browder. And Earl Browder was the head of the Communist Party. Yes, he was head of the Communist Party. He's head of the Communist Party. He's the one who changes the name of the Communist Party from the American Communist Party to the American Communist Committee. And he comes out with that slogan, communism is Americanism. and it's part of the Popular Front struggle. And I mean, Browder's eventually kicked out and, you know, brought up on charges for essentially de-radicalizing the Communist Party. I mean, right? So he sort of forced out. But early on here, he's writing columns in this paper. There are other folks who are looking at the labor struggle. There's columns looking at the Black-Jewish relationship, the close-knit ties between Blacks and Jews. But like I said, the big issue is the police brutality for the People's Voice. In this day and age where we have video cameras, right? This stuff didn't exist back in the 1940s, but this paper sort of served like other Black papers, and keeping people informed about these incidents. But this paper went beyond that. It always took the side of the victim. Always, always countered the police narrative of the story. Always challenged it. Gathered eyewitnesses to refute the police version and then back the victims. Organized huge, massive demonstrations against police brutality and proposed a number of solutions to take him on, including the hiring of Black police officers, but not just on the low level. Promoting them, you know, and they said in particular detectives who are out there doing the investigation, you know, that's what we need, loads of detectives, because there are practically none in the Harlem community, Black detectives. They challenged the grand jury system back in the 1940s. That has come under attack now, but Adam Clayton Powell was raising this back in the 1940s. We need to sort of rethink this system, how we investigate police officers. You know. And what he was doing and what others were doing was talking about how we can democratize policing in the city. how we can put more power in the hands of the citizens. And other groups that would take this on, this issue of police brutality, also made similar arguments. So in the book, I look at the Nation of Islam, who had a protracted campaign against police brutality in New York City. The American Communist Party is another organization I take a look at. In addition, by the 1950s and 60s, I look at civil rights organizations such as the Congress of Racial Equality, whose headquarters were in New York City. In fact, by the mid-1960s, they are the leading organization, civil rights organization, a national organization, taking on police brutality in New York City. Yes?
Just as a pitch for, hi guys, I'm Alex, I work here at Brooklyn Historical Society. We have a core collection in the library upstairs. I don't know what you guys were looking at up there. We're using that in a curriculum right now, and it's got all of those things that you're talking about. They did, and the one that we haven't talked about yet is they also tackled housing discrimination.
Yes, they did tackle housing.
The primary sources up there are sounding.
Alex, when you say that you have a curriculum, meaning what, is this like a lesson plan? So you have online available for teachers to use in their classrooms?
Yeah, it's in a pilot year now. We've been working, we were funded by the NEH, and we're working with Turnaround Art Schools. It pairs the Created Equal Freedom Riders documentary with the online curriculum, and we've been pairing our Northern civil rights documents with them to expand that story, so you're not just looking at the Freedom Riders, but you're looking at how it was reflected in Brooklyn, specifically. So we piloted it with two middle schools this year, and it'll be expanding to four this year, and then hopefully I can share it with you all after that.
High schools?
Middle school. Targeted middle school.
High school's going to be part of the expansion?
Oh, yeah. Right now it's a middle school curriculum.
Sorry,
yeah, oh no, that's sorry. Great. I'm glad.
But it's an amazing collection. Arnie Goldwag was the press secretary of CORE, and we have his collection upstairs.
Yeah, he's one of the persons I interviewed when I was working on the Black Churches of Brooklyn and the sort of downstate medical center campaign. And I know Brian Purnell also.
That's right.
Yeah.
And Brian created that archive, basically.
Oh, you did? Okay. Great. Yeah. All right.
Questions, since you bring that up, is there information in the CORE archives about what you mentioned earlier with the schools, with the unions, and in particular the school bus, the school?
The boycott.
Yeah, because you said that the civil rights, there were some civil rights organizations that were involved, and then they all pulled back. Do they actually talk about that in their papers?
So I can answer, because it's the archive upstairs, and I've been working pretty closely with it. They have a lot, because he was the press secretary, they have a lot of the outreach and a lot of the affirma from it, though kind of the internal organizing documents are not in our collection.
Yeah. Yeah, that's sort of hard to get at why these organizations pulled out, but there are people who do speak out, and you know, it shows up like in the New York Times, for example. There is a consistent criticism of Glamis's leadership. That's pretty clear. And as I noted in it's Glamison's FBI file, where Via Rustin is complaining to King about Glamison. It's sort of well known, I think, among folks at that time, and I also interview people who were part of that struggle, and they say, yeah, he's sort of a rough guy in terms of the way he was more authoritarian, and he can be in sort of this struggle, you have to be sort of more democratic. So I was sort of in this portion, and then we can talk about how to teach. I think I'm supposed to talk a little about that, right? I think that's...
We'll probably take like a 10-minute break.
Okay.
Portion's over and just let everybody move around.
Sure, yeah. But before we do that, can I ask if there are questions? because I know I've been going on for some time. Yes.
Yeah, I want to start with the question of police brutality. Do you think from your work did you find any way or science to say we can't address brutality without looking at just the basic old Marxist model that if you don't improve the living situation, it is a question of superstructural ideology. So is that
without a doubt.
Diversity?
Without a doubt. You are correct. I'm glad you say that, because there are a number of reasons people give for police brutality, right? And you just mentioned one, right? That there are others who talk about the bad apple theory, right? The bad cops, you know, there are a few of them. You know, there are people who talk about, you know, the social and economic conditions are terrible, but cops are not social workers. We've heard this about Giuliani, right? He was going on about that just recently. Right. They're not social workers, they have to do their job, so what you have to do is essentially train people and teach people to be respectful to the police. Bratton has made that argument. You know, so you got all these theories out there, but here's essentially what I'm arguing. The police have too much damn power. Mm-hmm. And they're given more and more power when you look at the offenses people are just being arrested for or harassed for. You know, so stop and frisk, broken windows have been disastrous. And these aren't just policies in New York, you know, they're international, I should know, right? I mean, I just got back from Palestine. I was 2 weeks there in Palestine, and it's just absolutely horrendous. The policing that's essentially not policing, it's not police who are carrying it out, the military is carrying this out, you know, of Palestinians and Palestinian communities. So, you know, and it sort of dawned me long ago, the Amadou Diallo case. Where these guys who don't identify themselves, right? They're essentially in street clothes, run against this guy who's running for his life, kill him, and they control the crime scene. They have committed the crime, but they control the crime scene. Right? Watch that video of the guy in the young man who was shot in Minnesota. Mm-hmm. And notice how the police control the crime scene. They have just murdered someone, but they're completely in control. So, you know, it just sort of dawned on me that they have too much power, and that we really have to sort of address this, and we have to sort of empower people. And this is what people have been saying long ago, back in the 1930s and 1940s and 1950s. Now, if you really want to sort of deal with this problem, I don't care, you can have all the sensitivity training. Right? You know, you could talk about community policing all you want. I heard Bratton on the other day talking about, yes, we need a closer relationship with the community. Under whose terms? Mm-hmm. What does that mean? You know, people should be involved in policing from the hiring to evaluation of police in the communities, right? In terms of civilian complaint review boards, you know, all this stuff should be used. And of course, no one wants to talk about that. In New York City, it's extremely hot because, I said, the police gain so much power, political power. And so, you know, that's essentially how I would sort of address that. Yes?
I'm a teacher in a New York City public school, and we were talking about the social unionism.
Oh, social unionism, yeah.
Does that exist in any form today? You were saying that you have to use more like a bread and butter.
Well, we saw it in Chicago. We see it in Chicago, for example, right? On the core, right? Karen Lewis, I'm sorry?
Sorry, yeah. There's a New York City teacher group that's based off of core.
Yeah, that's right. There is, right? The collective, what's it called?
No, that's more.
More, okay. Well, yeah, there are a number of small groups.
Yes, yeah, movement of rank and file educators.
Yes, that's right. Movement of rank and file, then is something called something, collective of radical educators.
The New York Collective of Radical Educators is based out of NYU.
That's right. So, I mean, you have a number of these small, but I mean, no one's really in charge. You still have, you know, the same people running the union, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. More combined, a couple of years ago, more based off of the success of the core strikes.
Yeah.
Combined a couple of the left dissensionist teacher union caucuses. They were like Teachers for Justice, ICE, the Independent Community of Educators, and GEM, the Grassroots Education Movement combined, and Moore is there. Moore is, I guess, would be like the union group, and NICOR is kind of the more pedagogy group, though the two have share a lot of membership in the same.
Sure. Sure, yeah, so, but they have to challenge the union leadership, right?
They won some slots on the high
school. Oh, they did? Okay.
I think they won on the high school e-board this year.
Right, there was
and they increased their representation.
Okay.
But the way the UFT does elections, they wait, like the retirees can vote, and way more retirees vote than active teachers.
Okay.
And they changed it so that they do it proportionally now. It's an insane system.
Okay. An insane system, okay.
That's my former life.
Yeah.
Being fired from the teacher.
I guess what lecture takes a little bit more on the whole communist movement and how did it intersect with, say, people in Harlem and in Brooklyn in terms of civil rights and community empowerment.
Good question. Starting in the 1920s, the American Communist Party, I guess from an edict from Moscow, decided it needed to sort of look at the sort of national liberation struggles. And especially by 1928, the Communist Party moves into something known as its third period. And this third period from 1928 to 1934 is really a sort of radical period where they noted that revolution was just sort of around the corner, you know, capitalism was falling. And, you know, we need to sort of be more vigilant and helping create a Soviet America, right? But you know, at the forefront of that struggle, of course, are African Americans, the most oppressed group in the United States. And the Communist Party noted that one way of sort of bringing them in to the party is to sort of push the Black Belt thesis. Now, the Black Belt thesis is this notion that blacks are a nationally oppressed group. You know, and so as a nationally oppressed group, they have a right to their own land. And for the communists, this was the former Confederate States, right? Now, it's a so-called Black Belt, right? And that's what they. So, at the same time that they're pushing this, I noted the Communist Party is sort of schizophrenic too. Yeah. At the same time that they're pushing this theory, they're also working extremely hard at wiping out what they call white chauvinism in the party, and you know, attempting to integrate black comrades. And they've been pretty fierce on this front. They organize in Harlem, for example, which has sort of one of the largest in terms of black representation, one of the sort of largest numbers that they're coming out of in Harlem. And there's a wonderful book on that by Mark Nason called Terrible Title, Great Book. Wait, communists in Harlem during the Depression, right? Gets right to the point, but...
We met with Mark a couple of days ago.
Oh, you did?
Yeah. But it was about Brock's history, not about communist history.
Okay. Well, that's a wonderful book he wrote, you know, back in the 1980s, and noting the huge black membership of the American Communist Party. And the Communist Party does, it really steps up in that struggle for civil rights, you know, in terms of they're most successful in the labor movement. Because by the mid-1930s, of course, the Congress of Industrial Organizations is formed, right? And many of those national organizations in the CIO are communist-led, or have a number of communists on their executive boards, and they all carve out a sort of civil rights agenda. I mentioned one, the teachers union is one of these, because it eventually winds up in the CIO, and they carve out the civil rights agenda that I sort of described to you. So they're taking that on, but they're also not just doing labor work, they're also doing community work. Organizing against police brutality. And there are black communists who are in the lead in this in New York City. Two important people, Benjamin Davis, who elected to the New York City Council, first communist, he was first communist elected to that position. And he really campaigns against police brutality. His office puts out a pamphlet called Northern Lynching, looking at police brutality. The other black communist is William Patterson, who was head of the National Civil Rights Congress, head of the Ninth National Civil Rights Congress. And they take on police brutality. In 1951, they put out their petition, "We Charge Genocide." Really document hundreds of cases throughout the country, and they focus, there are a lot of cases in New York City that they turn to looking at police brutality. And I'm lucky, I just spent 2 weeks, and when I said I was in Palestine, one of the people on the trip was the daughter of William Patterson. She was on the trip, and we had an interesting discussion, and she has his papers and said, "I can come and see these papers, you know," but when she gets settled back in New York City. But the party's out there on those fronts, and they become communist even when the Communist Party is at its low point. Many of its members don't just when the party sort of almost non-existent, some of those folks are still working, communists and some former communists and civil rights organizations. I mentioned people like Annie Stein, who was a member of the American Communist Party, who is the person who gets Glamis involved in the school integration campaign. And you go throughout the country, you see the role that communists are playing in this struggle for social justice. Yes?
I was wondering if you could speak a little bit to how you tackle the issue of the PBA in your work. That's one thing you mentioned, Marilyn Johnson's book, and I'm thinking that's something that I would like to see a little more of her discuss in there.
You'll see it in my book.
Yeah, that's what I was hoping. Specifically because you're talking about, and I was glad you mentioned it, the political power of the police.
Yeah, the PBA finds itself at odds in for the first time with the city administration. You know, before that, PBA never had to worry about support coming from the mayor's office. Even the liberal mayor, Robert Wagner, will not step out and criticize the police department. So there are numerous cases where the police are involved in all kinds of shenanigans. They do wind up getting a civilian complaint review board in 1953. And Johnson does talk about this, but the civilian complaint review board that they get in 1953 consists of three deputy commissioners. That's it. Three deputy commissioners. And the only reason they settle for that is because the New York City Police Department was under investigation by the Justice Department. And there was a scandal involved. They tried to buy off being investigated and so forth. And it's, you know, the civil rights community sort of brings this out, particularly one lawyer who's working with the Nation of Islam sort of brings this out. You know, hey, these guys are fooling around here. We need to invest. They are not investigating these brutal attacks on and killings of black people in New York City. So they wind up with this so-called civilian complaint review board that goes on for some years, and of course police brutality just keeps going on and on and on. And when the Harlem riot erupts and the Bedford-Stuyvesant erupts in 1964, you know, that's when it's okay, this is it. I mean, you gotta do something. And then city council members start pushing civilian complaint review board proposals. Of course, the civil rights community is there. That 64 riot brings all the national leaders from the civil rights. They all come to New York City. Martin Luther King is hanging out here in New York. In fact, he's criticized completely because Wagner brings him here. And, you know, local people like Adam Clayton Powell says, you know, get out of here, we don't need you. You know, essentially, you know, we're here. You know, and so, you know, he's criticized harshly, but its core sort of steps up, and Lika's core is already here. You know, core has an office here, and core is really pushing for the civilian complaint review board. But Wagner refuses. He backs the police to the end. And then when he loses, when he decided not to run, it's a Republican mayor who promises, if I'm elected, you're going to get a civilian complaint review board. And that Republican was John Lindsay. And Lindsay, sure enough, through an executive order, creates a civilian complaint review board consisting of four civilians, three police officers. That proposal was even too much for the police. And they led a vicious campaign to dismantle the Civilian Complaint Review Board. The head of the PBA, a man by the name of John Cassess, leashes out the most racist attacks on the Civilian Complaint Review Board, on civil rights leaders, on Lindsay. And people say he's irrational, he's this, but you know, he's this and that, but he's not. He's a shrewd person. He's galvanizing white resentment. He's essentially galvanizing white support and building up white resentment. And William F. Buckley, Jr., the icon of modern conservatism, is in the city, and he joins in this campaign. This really makes Buckley this struggle in 1966. And eventually they force a referendum. And the police win. They overturn the Civilian Complaint Review Board. And the police win through their actions legally and essentially organizing, going out on the streets, carrying out these sort of civil disobedience campaigns. And they come up with this narrative that is with us today, that if the police, the Civilian Complaint Review Board, I got a commercial I can show you on this that they used in that campaign. You know, you unleash, you tie the hands of the police, you unleash the criminals, and it's clear what they were saying, that you are tying the hands of the police and you are unleashing all these black criminals on white New Yorkers.
Yeah.
And they even have an ad that appears in the New York Daily News, and I think other papers, of a young white woman coming out of the subway at night.
What year is the campaign?
66.
66.
Yes. Coming out and noting under the captions, you know, we're not going to be around to protect her. So, and this works wonderfully for the PBA. And they trounce that referendum, they trounce the review board. They beat it 3-1. And it's clear where all the support's coming from. It's coming from white New Yorkers who are overwhelmingly voting for it, whereas black and Latinos are voting for the civilian, and support the Civilian Complaint Review Board. So people point to 68 as a sort of dividing line between blacks and whites in New York City. No, go to 66 and look at the PBA and its campaign. And that was powerful. And they use that narrative every time they feel they are under threat. So in the mid-70s, they use that campaign during the fiscal crisis. Mm-hmm. When Mayor Abe Beam is cutting city services, and he wants to cut the police force, he's cutting teachers and so forth. Teachers don't have that much power. The police lead this campaign. And they go to airports, passing out leaflets, warning people, do not stay in New York because your life is in danger. And if you do stay here, here's a bunch of things that you have to do. In your hotel room, stay there at night. Don't go out at night. If you do, you must walk with someone. I mean, it's just vicious the way they do this. And they sort of fight back on the cuts. And other mayors that come after that say, we're essentially with the police. Ed Koch gives his interview, and he says, I love the police. In fact, every time we went to negotiations, I wanted to kick in more, 1-3% more for the police. And they backed the police to them. And so de Blasio winds up, look at the trouble that de Blasio wound up in. And they were using that sort of false narrative. So they have managed, the PBA has managed to immense, great amount of power. And you see, they use it every time that they feel threatened.
Don't forget Giuliani used the police against Dinkins.
Yes, right. Well, essentially, that's right. That riot that the police carried out. Pulling black passengers from cars and beating them.
Yeah, Giuliani.
That's right, Giuliani was up. Yes.
I saw this already great quote earlier that talks about the power of the police, and it says, we live in a world where trained cops can panic and act on impulse, but untrained civilians must remain calm with a gun in their face.
Yeah.
Right.
Yes.
So yeah, that's, unless we address this problem of, the immense power that police have,
But Professor, you went to Palestine. What we are seeing in parallel, what we are dealing really with is the rise of fascism in the United States. And people must pay attention to that. People turn a blind eye to it in Germany. We should never forget what fascism does. If you listen carefully to Donald Trump, Donald Trump is a fascist. We think, we know we clung off on Donald Trump, and we say he's stupid. Don't say that. They say that about Hitler. don't say that about, because fascism is creeping all over the world. Mm-hmm. And you see, anytime you see police is being militarized, pay attention to that. That is fascism.
I want to need some time for, you said you were going to be able to speak with us briefly about how one would teach some of this material, right?
Yeah.
And then also, we were going to, I did bring this up earlier, we're going to ask you to sign, we have copies of your book.
Oh, yeah, sure.
I did ask you about this in advance.
Yeah, I can get it online and show you this, but because there are a number of sites that you can go to, depending on the topic. For the New York City Teachers Union, best source. Oh, good, okay. We have these photos. This is a photo of the first eight teachers who were fired from the system, who were put on trial, and then eventually fired from the system. And so the other number of slides that I show here, these are at the Tamamit. There are hundreds of these the photos, and they can be used in the classroom. I've used them in the classroom with undergraduate students. I have not used them teaching high school, but I think they can be used even in a high school class. They raise a whole bunch of questions. You can use it, for example, if you're teaching a section on the Cold War. What was the Cold War? What impact did the Cold War have domestically? Now when you talk about the international Cold War, you can talk about its domestic impact. Now, on the labor movement, for example, the Cold War and labor, right? Cold War and civil rights. Well, the purges were really important. They had a devastating impact on the civil rights movement and, of course, on labor. So here's a case where these teachers are, this photo appeared in the New York Times, for example. First eight teachers who are essentially brought up on charges by the New York City Board of Education, and they are eventually fired. And what's the charge? Insubordination. That's the charge. All except for one guy, and that was this guy, Freeland, who they just outright said he was a member of the Communist Party. He was simply subjecting students upon communist propaganda and so forth. The other people that they brought up, they said, they refused to answer the questions, and therefore they were insubordinate, and so they fired. And this includes dozens of teachers who lost their jobs this way. So, I mean, this can raise a question, I think. So what's the impact of this? The teachers who are teaching black history. These are the teachers who are working in the communities and so forth. So you remove them from the system, what impact does that have, right? On the history curriculum, what does it have on activities after school, working with parents in the communities, and so on and so forth. So it had sort of a devastating impact. So I think these slides can be used. There are a number of these slides looking at the teachers who were part of the system that can be used in the classroom. Well, okay, so let me just talk about it then. And you can write this down. It's a site called Dreamers and Fighters.
Dreamers
and Fighters. The New York City Teacher Purges. That's the subtitle. Pull that up online. New York City Teachers Purges. And it's a site created by a person by the name of Lori Styler, who was the cousin of a person who was working on the film on the New York City Teachers Union. That cousin unfortunately passed away. Lori took over the project, but she and some friends created the site where they have interviewed loads of teachers who have been purged from the system. They have videos on the site where you have interviews from many of the teachers. And that's something that, that also you can use, I think you can bring into the classroom. If you are doing something on the Cold, once again on the Cold War, if you are doing a New York City history course, it's one course I teach at Baruch College, history, the modern history of New York City, of course we have to focus on education. How the battles over education in New York City. There are ongoing battles in education. And so what does it mean, like it said, you know, what do these teachers add to this whole struggle? Well, we got that again, but.
Which one did you not need this anymore, or?
Probably not. I mean, okay. I think we're finished with the,
okay.
Yeah. I just wanted to see if I can get online and.
I'll call Alex upstairs and see if he can give us an assist.
Okay, great, because a lot of these sites are online sites. There is a documentary that you can just pull up on YouTube. I think that is also very helpful, especially when looking at the history of the Cold War. It's called Seeing Red. Great title, Seeing Red. And it talks about sort of communist hysteria that hits the United States in the late 1940s and 1950s. That you can put it sort of in context for the students. All right, now in terms of the sources for what I talked about when I talked about the school integration campaign, lots of good sources on that one also that you can get online. There are a number of, well, there's one important, I think, interview with Milton Glamison. It's called the site is New York City School Boycott, 1964. And it's a video by Critical Commons. It's called Critical Commons. And there's this interview with Glamison explaining why the boycott. This is a YouTube video of Malcolm X and why he was supporting the New York City boycott. Something I didn't talk about. And 1964, I mentioned February 3rd, 1964, was the first citywide boycott. There was another one in March of 1965. Excuse me, not 64, not 65. This is the one without the support of the civil rights organizations because they all walked away by this time. But Malcolm X steps in and throws his support behind Glamison. And there he is, you can look at a YouTube interview. Oh, hopefully we'll make the connection, but there, Malcolm X decides he is going to support it. He's explaining why he's throwing his support behind Glamison and the boycott. And he notes, because the reporter asked him, he said, I thought you were for segregation. My boy said, I'm never for segregation. Never supportive of segregation. You know? Segregation is essentially something that's being done to you, right? And he sort of defines that. But the reality is that Malcolm X had developed a close relationship with Milton Glamison. And in a letter that he writes to Glamison, he notes, he says, you know, Yeah, I am with you, essentially, in your struggle, as I hope you remain with me in my struggle. And this is after he has left the Nation of Islam. So that's an interesting video that one could use to make you explore Malcolm X, but also, you know, essentially who's supporting this movement in 1964. Because Malcolm X has been critical of the civil rights movement in the past, right? Statements that he has made criticizing that movement. And here he's in 64, like I said, Donnie, giving his support to this struggle in New York City. In addition to those two videos I mentioned, the Clarence one, let me note the WNYC just a couple of months ago, and you can get this online, and this, of course, is an audio, so you would have, your students would have to listen to it, but it goes into the history, a short history of that New York City school boycott and that struggle for school integration. And the name of his, it's on WNYC, the name of his demand for school integration leads to massive 1964 boycott. It's demand for school integration leads to massive New York 1964 boycott. And that's easy to pull up if you have internet connection. Now, in terms of the sources for I think the struggle over police brutality, there are also a number of sites that one can use. The Harlem riots, there are a few very short ones. So I mean, these aren't long films, but they can definitely be used in the classrooms. So there are about three or four of them just under the title. Oh, there we go. Okay, very good. Start, I hope we have sound now. Okay, let's see. Well, not yet, we're going to have to free. It's a nice sign. Brooklyn Core supports the boycott. There's Malcolm. Unfortunately, Nelson.
It's low.
Oh, it's very low, okay.
Can you put these sites on the canvas?
This one, it's Fighters and Dreamers.
Yeah, I'll give you this list if you want.
Thank you.
Okay. Thanks. Yeah, it's kind of hard to hear. It's too low, so.
Is there a
closed caption
option?
Yes.
Yes.
That's building a lab, isn't it? Yeah, that's building a lab. Okay. Thank you. That was helpful. So that one, I think it's that's a good one to use. I mentioned the Glamison interview. That's very good. I probably won't pull it up because it's going to probably be just as low as that one. But the ones on the... Okay, what we got here? Good, okay. I was mentioning the ones on the police brutality. Thank you. Yeah, the Museum of the City of New York some years ago did an exhibit on John Lindsay. May John Lindsay. And you can go on their site, Museum of the City of New York, under social activism. Social activism and civil rights. And there are a number of videos, and there's one where Lindsay is giving a press conference and he shows the PBA ad that I was talking about earlier. Where the cops are making the argument that essentially the Civilian Complaint Review Board will endanger white citizens. There's Lindsay there, along with Senator Robert Kennedy, who was a supporter of the Civilian Complaint Review Board, and Senator Jacob Javits, who was also a supporter of the review board. And in terms of police brutality, this brings up Malcolm X again. There is a wonderful YouTube video of Malcolm X discussing police brutality in New York. In fact, it was used yesterday. I don't know if you can go back and listen to the Brian Lehrer show on NPR. Did you hear it yesterday where Erica Gardner was on?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Well, I don't know if you remember how Brian Lehrer started. He started up with Malcolm X. Discussing police brutality in New York City. And that comes from this video that you can get online where Malcolm is discussing, you know, essentially how the police are justifying brutalizing and killing black people. So those are some of the online sites that I would use, and I think you can use them in the classroom, because you know I did teach high school for a while, and I know that you have to really keep the attention of high school students, because you know it's difficult. You know, you can't give them a lecture, right? So I think you know these photos, along with these videos, are. Or really get to spark a discussion. Now, I mentioned how you can use the teachers union, you know, and you know sections talking about the Cold War, or if you're doing something on New York City history, or if you're doing something on urban education, focusing on education. That's easy. I think that this is also true with when you're looking at policing, right? If you're teaching social studies, it's easy to include that in your courses, right? I'm not sure. I think that's also true in English courses. Outside of those fields, it probably would be a little more difficult to incorporate that into your lesson plans. But nevertheless, I think you know. For all teachers, you know, this stuff is pretty good. And I'm sure you can find a way, creative way, if you're a science teacher, incorporating this stuff, right? So let me ask any questions. Well, let me ask you a few questions. I mean, how many people do teach? do teach this, you know, materials on the civil rights movement, on
good. All right. Are you saying currently, or even those who are, say, doctoral students who plan to in the future may not be doing so now?
But I'm more interested in how they do it.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. I'm interested in, so how do you sort of raise these issues? Yeah.
I teach a section on the Cold War, the Cold War. So one of the things I incorporate in terms of you YouTube videos looking at Cold War in different parts of the world, in the United States, Cuba, Vietnam. So I try to use this one. So engage the students. You know, while you're reading the text, you know, I want you to see it live. Look at Chile. Ali and the first 9/11. When we talk about 9/11, I said the first 9/11 did not happen in the United States.
Right,
but
right.
Chile.
You
see it and you understand the connections.
Mm-hmm. I teach composition and I use Spike Lee's Do the Right Thing to teach police brutality.
Oh, okay.
This past semester we started with like creating safe spaces and what that meant because my students are predominantly white.
Yeah.
And then we looked at a couple of YouTube videos, and that was to prepare them for what they were about to engage with Spike Lee's Do the Right Thing. But I had a question.
Sure. I was going to ask how the students were doing, how do they react to that?
So because we created this safe space, they were okay. And this was about the fourth year that I've done it. But in the beginning, the first year, some like pushback. And it depended on the student population. So if I had a class with more black students, there was less pushback. I even noticed one year that the class would laugh at certain times. So maybe the first class, they were cracking up laughing if it was something that they could relate to, whereas the other class, they were afraid to laugh at a particular part. So it took, in that one year I stopped because I was just tired of the pushback, but it took time to prepare, to figure out how to incorporate that to where everyone can be comfortable discussing it. But so New York City is still the number one state that has segregated schools in the country. And with all the work that was being done, why do you think that is? And I feel like if you look at other states across the country, it's probably equal in terms of the fact that schools are still segregated.
In New Jersey, have you go to travel? So I live in New Jersey, and I've been in some of the schools, especially in the suburban areas. Can't believe how segregated these schools are in terms of, you know, predominantly all white student bodies. The Gary Orfield study, right? You're talking, referring to that one there. So when I found that New York State has the most segregated schools in the nation, you know, and that was what, 2 years ago, right? They just came out with this. And the question is the reason why. Well, one important reason that is given in that report is the emergence of charter schools.
Yeah.
And they have had a profound impact in segregating, you know, student bodies, right? Yeah, in fact, he referred to them, I think in the report, they were referred to as apartheid schools, mm-hmm. right, some of these schools. There hasn't been a campaign to integrate the schools. Yeah. That's sort of gone by, you know. So without that, I think that push also. You know, this has become a major reason why we aren't dealing with segregated schools. Yes?
So I teach a seminar that is resistance to rebellion and revolution, and we kind of look at the civil rights movement.
Where do you teach or something?
At the seminar in Megara.
Oh, okay, that's right. That's right. Okay.
So we kind of look at not just the civil rights movement, but just a lot of the resistance movements and how they develop into rebellion and at some level of revolution, so-called revolution.
Okay. And so you look at
that content.
Content, okay, great.
I use the autobiography of Malcolm X in the social psych course to show the evolution of Malcolm X through his words. So as he's starting out and talking about his life, and then as he changes, and then I link it to different course concepts that we're discussing in social psych. So I assign it at the end of the course so they get, like, you know, all the different social psychological concepts, and then by then we can do all the application. So I can say, this is relating to this, this is relating to this, this is relating to this. And then by the end of the book, you're showing like the full evolution of Malcolm X. And then in the course, the theme is also, I'm getting them to stretch their imaginations and their minds and try and evolve. So that's also related to the theme.
I have a question.
Sure.
How do you talk about, like, when we talk about integration, there's this assumption that there's a majority and you're just like, that there's something that you're integrating to that's the best, or this is the standard, and so I'm integrating into it. It reminds me of like diversity in the arts, where like, let's sprinkle a couple black people into this predominantly majority white space, and then it'll be a perfect rainbow, and everybody will be cool. So like, how do you talk about integration without saying, I mean, like, integration is racist to me, because, like, do you know what I mean?
I know to be like, this. I know exactly what you mean. That's an argument that has been used by many people, you know. Let me talk about the way the folks did in New York and elsewhere, you know. When they talked about integration, they talked about creating a much more democratic society. Not sort of minority, majority sort of communities, but communities where, you know, people could share, you know, not materials, but also, you know, public space. No one should be denied. And when they talk about integration, that's integration of the student body, but integration of the professional staff. They said that's extremely important, not just for, you know, role models, but once again, yeah, demonstrating that, you know, we have to have this sort of open democratic society. And so, you know, that's the way they presented it. You know, you can, you know, take it or leave it, but you know, they clearly were not making the argument, you know, that white is better. You know? In fact, Glamison always made the argument that white children are harmed by, you know, segregation. So, you know, I remember walking into the first summer when I started teaching years ago, this place called Lemoyne College. And I remember I couldn't find a room. And this Lemoyne College is a Jesuit institution in Syracuse, New York, where the student body is 96-97% white. And I was teaching this class and they couldn't find it. It was located in the science building. And I asked this white student who was also looking for the classroom, and she told me, just be quiet. We'll find it. I said, okay, say a word. And when she walked in the classroom, I walked up front to the room, her mouth dropped. And then, of course, she beautifully apologized to me afterwards. No, I didn't fail.
I'm curious, did she drop the class?
No, she stayed in the class. She stayed. I made her feel completely comfortable.
Okay.
But you understand what I'm saying in terms of the impact that this has. And so, you know, this is the argument that Glamison was making. You see it in his sermons and his writings, you know, when he gave out, you know, public talks to the folks throughout the city. You know, this isn't just benefiting, you know, black children, you know, this is benefiting all children, you know. And we can say the same thing about affirmative action, by the way, I think to some degree. Yes.
And just to her question too, which I think is a great one, we like try to frame to our students too that like integration was a strategy that some folks supported and that ended up happening. But there's been kind of this long history of black nationalism in part, like lots of folks who think that integration was a huge mistake or point to kind of the ways HBCUs and Black Wall Street, like certain things were able to thrive in specific ways before that change was made. And, you know, we can talk, folks can talk about whether they agree or disagree with that, right? But just that assumption that integration is the best strategy, like, is an assumption, like, in and of itself.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, and people had, you're right, assumptions, well, you know, they had different visions, I would say. Yes?
I make a distinction. I don't use integration as much as I use desegregation.
Yeah, Barbara Ramsey.
I actually tend to make that, you know, distinction because of the very reason that you mentioned. And then also it makes it easier for me to talk about the concept of resegregation with cases like Shuff versus O'Neill in Connecticut. And then just in answer to the other question that you asked about those of us who teach civil rights movement, I actually do, but I tend to teach in different ways. So where I am now in a Black Studies department, I have a course that is just called the Civil Rights Movement, but I also teach social movements. So when I teach the Civil Rights Movement, I actually now think that instead of focusing on the Southern Civil Rights Movement and then sort of doing this whole separate kind of discussion of the Northern activities as though they were not quite the civil rights movement, I need to kind of think about a way of integrating those so that I'm not making the distinction between civil rights movement and black power movement as though these movements weren't occurring in different ways around the country.
Yeah. Yeah, Jean Theo Harris and others have made the argument, I think this guy, I'm sorry? Yeah, I'm thinking of Lassiter, Michael Lassiter. You know, have made the argument, and have been criticized for it, I should know, that we make these dichotomies. So, what's his name, who wrote that book on Radio Free Dixie?
Tyson,
he's another one who sort of makes this argument, you know, about the roots of the Black Power movement, right? Starting early on, you know, we go back and look at this and see that, you know, we probably have put too much emphasis on making these sort of distinctions of these movements. Of course, they've been greatly criticized for that by a number of historians who are sort of blurring the lines.
But it means that when we teach we're choppy in the way we teach them. Yeah. So we need to be careful about
that. Right. Mr. Jeff, we have time for one more question, and then book signing.
Sure.
I think we said we were going to be done with room at 4, as we told them.
Oh,
okay. So why don't we take field one more question, or if not, we can go straight to book signing.
There was a question.
It's not a question, it's a comment. Two others that I thought of is Eyes on the Prize. So you can select out, if you're covering something that's related
to... Yes, I meant to mention that.
You can select out something from Eyes on the Prize that's related to, I mean, it's all civil rights, but like particular sections or experiences. Another one that's really good that I've shown in my class is the Black Power mixtape. So that's another...
Well, let me know. No, there's Eyes on the Prize too, right?
Yes.
That's one and two. That's
a, there's a whole.
And but they come to the north and
yeah,
and,
right.
Yeah. And there's one in New York and the whole Attica. That's right.
Okay. Thank you so much, Professor.
No, you take it.
And I'll post this to our website tonight.
Professor Taylor, we have a long-standing tradition here at STSI. It goes back hundreds of years to our forefathers and foremothers 12 months ago when we first had STSI. This is our commemorative STSI tote bag. In it, you will also find a specially embossed Institute for Research in Africa. Why are you all laughing? So every time I say this, things will be hot.
Oh, look at that.
We have a commemorative embossed iris water bottle.
All right.
Thank you so much.
All right.
It's a real pleasure.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.